Hi everyone, it's an absolute pleasure to be here. Today I'm going to talk about structured data. Of course, what is it? Why do you need it? What the benefits? Some of those questions I will be addressing. Which ones you should go for? Also not unimportant. And some of the common mistakes that we often make. I'll be discussing some tools as well, including their failures, and where we as SEO come in. Just for the sake of argument. One second. Clicker doesn't work. Off button. This clicker has an off button. I'm hoping that, yes, that works. Now, you may have seen structured data and not realize this structured data by the nice visualization in Google search results. That means that we have to include that on our website so Google can crawl it and use that. We see that then in the Google search results, but also in the Google Search Console. We see back how this is implemented. Now, it's very important to keep in mind that structured data is no guarantee that it will be shown. If you implement structured data on your website, there's absolutely no guarantee that Google will use it. In addition to that, there is no ranking boost. There's no reason for Google to say, okay, now we're going to rank you higher. That having said, there is a good chance you'll get an increased CTR. So from this perspective, we are very interested in SEO because we get bigger real estate potential because we can push down our competitors a little bit, you know, in the SERPs and other things like that. We can get more click-through rate because we look nice. Now this is where structured data comes in. For Google, it actually means that Google can better dedupe the content. It can basically see what the differences are. Now this actually becomes very important, for example, in e-commerce, where we can have a lot of products that are almost the same, and they may have a lot of the same qualities, etc., but there are minor differences. And with product schema, we can highlight that so that Google doesn't see that as duplicate content. So this is, again, one of the features and one of the benefits of using structured data. In addition to that, it also helps Google understand the website and the content in this context to it, so it knows what to rank it for. So this is really about helping Google better understand the website and the content, which we want for SEO. So which one should we go for? Well, we used to have data vocabulary, and most of the schema was originally based on that. We moved on to basically schema.org, which is a collaboration from different entities like Bing and Google trying to come up with a standard. There were some bugs in that, there still are. As such, this is not the one that Google actually recommends. Funny enough, they recommend their own. So I highlighted nicely in red, like here, you should really rely on the documentation of developers of Google as the developer, rather than schema.org documentation. They explicitly say, don't rely on schema.org, which I kind of find funny. What are some of the schemas that we should implement as a bare minimum on any website? The website schema with the search engine schema, with the organizational schema, local business schema, with the contact point schema. These are some of the schemas that we should have on basically every website, just to get started. And breadcrumb schema, and this one is actually quite important. And this can really nicely replace the URLs within the search results, and they tend to have, no guarantee, tend to have a slightly higher click-through rate. Now, which ones are there also available that we can use? There are opportunities, but it really depends on the content. Not every website has the same content, so you have to see when does it apply. Now here's a couple of them, articles, you know, you can go to sub-themas or blog posts, etc. I would keep it higher level whenever possible, to be honest. I wouldn't go too deep. If you have an article, call it an article. Yeah. Paywall stuff, we can talk product schema, we can talk events, recipes, reviews, job posting, etc. You know, video course, fact check, I always love that one. You know, especially in the world of today. Now, top places is also interesting, music, podcast. Now, some of these are actually pretty experimental. They're not fully embraced yet, or they're still developing it. Notebook, software app is actually quite an interesting one as well, if you deal with software. And I've seen pages where, for example, the thank you page for downloading the software is recognized as a soft 404. This could actually solve partially that problem. Yeah? These are the things that can help Google understand, no, this is actually a download page. Yeah? TV, movie, data sets, this is actually also an experimental, interesting one where we can give more data to Google and help them understand. And some of these that you just saw can also be tied together in a list. Now Google likes you to mark up individual specific pages. So if you have one product on one page, then use product schema. But if you have 20 different products, don't use product schema on all of those 20 products on the same page, unless, and that's the interesting part, you use something like Carousel. Now Carousel isn't supported for everything yet, but it's also still very much experimental. This was previously known as Rich Cards, and they're basically rebranding it as Carousels, and they will probably do this for all the other schemas as well that they support. So yeah, this is an interesting one to keep an eye on as well. So which one can we ignore? Well, we can safely ignore web page. We have WordPress, I think, for that one. And web page is one that pretty much no one uses except WordPress. Now we have these H entry, etc. They tend to toss a lot of errors, and often again, this comes because of WordPress. We can remove these if it's WordPress. If you have a WordPress site, just update your theme, please. You'll get rid of it, and then implement one of the other schemas. One of the other ones that you may want to be aware of, and I see this still a lot, is the data vocabulary version of breadcrumbs. A lot of websites implemented this at the time, and it makes total sense because it was recommended by Google. But the problem was that a few years ago, Google fixed the bug why they weren't using schema.org and were still recommending data vocabulary. They fixed the bug in a very nasty, hacky way. It's still there. Because data vocabulary allowed inheritance. So you could basically say, okay, here you have number one, two, and three, basically by the structure of the implementation. So you had levels based on how you implemented it, and schema.org didn't support that. As a result, you now have to add position numbers. Yeah, so they now have you have to declare, this is the first level, this is the second level, by adding a number. So it's a very hacky way, but okay, because of that, they basically said, okay, we solved the schema.org bug in breadcrumbs, so everyone will now move over to the other one. And the thing is that they've taken this off their documentation a long time ago already, and once critical mass has been moved over, I wouldn't expect them to honor this as necessary as a supported method. So keep that in mind, that at some point they may drop data vocabulary breadcrumbs. If you're still using that, you may want to upgrade to the breadcrumb list schema. In addition to that, so what are some of the ways of implementing? Well, we can use, obviously, third-party tools like, for example, Tag Manager to inject it within the website, but this is not a long-term solution because every crawl that Google does of your website or of your pages where you have to structure data, Google may actually say, okay, we're not counting the JavaScript this crawl, meaning that one crawl, it is there, the next call may not be, and then the call after that, it may be again. So you're starting to have very conflicting and changing messages. So although Tag Manager is an interesting tool and can be good for testing purposes in structured data, I would not see this as a long-term solution. The same goes also for the Data Highlighter, which is incorporated within Google Search Console for two simple reasons. One, we forget that we said it. So if we change our content, we forgot that we have to update it here as well, which is a big downside because you can really start messing things up that way within the search result and suddenly lose ranking not knowing why because someone has set the schema here and now everything is wrong. So this is one of those things. The other thing is, on this one as well, is no one else but Google sees it, which is a lost opportunity. So Bing and all the other ones don't see it. So I would, again, Data Highlighter, Google Tag Manager, great for experimental phase. Figure out which schema you want to implement, maybe get the first benefits, see if it works for you or not. But after that, implement it in the HTML code. We need it in the code, not just separated. That means we need to see it something like this. Yeah? So we have the option of inlining it, which is option number one, and which is the old-fashioned way. This has benefits, by the way, because, for example, in this situation there, you see that line, article body, and we actually see here the body of the article. This is something that we can do only with inline. We don't have to replicate the entire content. Yeah, but we can say what is the main content, which is a big benefit of inline. One of the downsides of inline is we change one thing in the HTML and the entire schema can be broken. Yeah, so this is something that we really have to worry about. As such, Google came with JSON-LD also, which was out already, but which Google implemented on from this supported from this perspective, and recommends now as the primary way. But we lose the benefit of highlighting what is the article body. Yeah, so we can still highlight the most important elements like headline or, you know, like author and stuff like that, but we lost the ability to highlight within JSON-ID without having to copy the entire thing what the article body is. We can include the article body, but we have to literally now present it twice, once in JSON-LD and once in the HTML, yeah, which is a downside. Now, Bing has confirmed that they're starting to support it as well. Good, because that means that we can now fully switch to JSON-LD. JSON-LD has the advantage that it's literally just in one place, and no matter if you change the content, the JSON-LD code still remains the same. So a couple of bonuses that you might want to think about or keep an eye on. So schema.org also has more coming and features and changes. This is all can be found on the pending.schema.org. There's some really interesting stuff there. You can also create your own schema and extend the current schema.org. So these are things that you can explore. You can also use third-party tools like Screaming Frog or DeepCrawl to basically extract the schema implementation on your website. So these are things that you can do as well. And there's a link here, by the way, at the bottom. Later on, when you have the slides, feel free to follow that. Now, Google, of course, doesn't want you to abuse your position in the search and how you basically use your structured data. So they have a couple of guidelines, and there's the Google Search Quality Team, which is there to save the day within Google, that it makes sure that people don't violate Webmaster Guidelines. Now, some of the more important Webmaster Guidelines on structured data are regarding making sure that you have something unique to sell, that you have updated information, that you have not hidden the content from your users that you're marking up. That's actually quite important, as well as not misleading. I'll show you some examples in a bit. It also has to be a true representation of the main content. If it's not that, you have a problem with Google. Obviously, it also needs to comply with the overall Google Webmaster Guidelines. Now, some common issues that people run into, it's actually quite easy to mess things up when it comes to structured data. First of all, don't lock it in robots.txt. You'd be surprised how often that happens. Like, yes, we did all of this implementation of structured data, but we're blocking it in robots.txt. Yeah? Another one is forgetting the recommended fields. If you can add them, please do, because these may become required at some point. You do need to keep checking recommended field if they update those to required, because the documentation does change. Yeah? What may be recommended today, really 6 months down the line, may be a required field. So start thinking about the recommended field as potentially required in the future and start gathering the data so by the time that it does switch, that you can switch with it. Yeah? Don't forget also the required fields. You'd be surprised how often that breaks the schema as well. So can you spot the problems in this particular slide?
A comma.
Yeah, that was definitely one, and easily highlighted. Do you guys see where the comma should be? Yes, no?
Yes.
Yeah?
Behind your name.
Quite easy, right? Because of that. Do you see the other issue?
Google Plus is there.
Yeah. Line 13.
Yeah, 13.
Yeah, it's not filling it out again.
Yeah, that's one. Yeah. What else?
Say 9 in the right.
Huh?
Say 9
Yes. You see here four times the same ass. It should only be once. It's a duplicate key issue now. Yeah, so this will only break. It's quite easy to break JSON-LD. It's actually quite strict. That's the whole problem with JavaScript, by the way, but that's a separate talk. Here's another example of where we see how easy it is to break things up within your structured data. Here we have the rating and we have a book schema. The problem is that we have marked it up separately in this situation, hence Google doesn't know that that rating is about that book. Yeah? We need to really be careful how we mark things up. Here we have the example of breaking. So here we have that same article as we saw a few slides ago. But now I added one closing article tag, one tag only. Now here we have some of the other data, yeah? But this schema is now broken up in two because of one change in the HTML. This is one of those examples where a change in HTML can break in line. This is why JSON-LD tends to be preferred. Yeah? So keep that in mind. Now we have a bunch of tools that we can use to optimize how we look at these things. You can literally use third-party tools like this tool, it's JLint. It allows you to validate the JSON code, the JavaScript code. It's pretty rudimentary, but yeah. You can play around on the JSON-LD playground, which is actually a pretty cool tool as well, freely open source available. Obviously, structured data tool from testing tool from Google, yeah, which also, by the way, gives us previews at times. So not for all schemas, but for a number of them, they will give us previews on how this may look like. So feel free to test that and do some fun stuff. However, this doesn't solve the problem of sending, avoiding conflicting signals. Conflicting signals is one of those areas where we as SEOs come in. Because all of these tools, they don't look for conflicting signals. They test if the code is valid or not, and that's it. It's a true or false situation. So here we have an example. According to the guidelines, the website schema should only be implemented once on the homepage. None of those tools tell me if it is or isn't. Yeah? They will tell me that the implementation of schema may be correct or incorrect, but they don't tell me if it's according to the guidelines. So this is where those tools fail. Yeah? Another example, they don't recommend it. Here's a regex that will allow you to extract it. They don't recommend it if you have both inline as well as JSON-LD on the same page for the same stuff, or even mix. Because the problem is, you're going to mess things up. You're going to send multiple signals. Now, you might think like, okay, yeah, but you know, if it's the same, what's the problem? Well, it doesn't need to be the same. You'll see that in the coming slides. But the problem really is that, yeah, you're messing things up. You're going to mess things up. Here's a simple example of how easy it can be to mess things up if you don't keep track of it. So here we have two website schema on the same page. And believe me, I've seen this happen, not just with website schema, also with product schemas, organizational schemas, etc. Yeah? Where we have, for example, a company has four stores. So they put four organizational schemas on one page with four addresses. Which one should Google use? They have four, so they don't use any. Yeah? Here's the example of two website schema. Now initially you might think, yeah, okay, that's fine, it's duplicate. But here's the thing, the first one has no www. Here one is on HTTPS and with the www. Yeah, so now we have two different website schemas, both promoting a different URL. On top of that, we have three search actions, which are all pointing to different URLs. So which one should Google use? The tools that we talked earlier about, including the Google Structured Data Testing Tool, will tell you that this is correct structured data. But this is where SEO comes in. This is where we need to come in, because this isn't correct. This is going to cause problems. This is conflicting signals. Yeah? We also want to make sure that we don't mismatch with our sitemaps. that we, the URLs that we show here, that they're the same ones in our assignments and our canonicals. Yeah? We need to make sure of that. And that's again where SEO comes in. Now, we also need to make sure that we use it on both desktop as well as mobile website if you have two different sites. So keep that in mind. This is again where SEO comes in, because none of those tools will tell you that. Yeah? They will tell you if it's correctly implemented or not if it's actually correctly implemented. And just, okay, this validates or not. So these are things that we need to keep in mind. Now, obviously, you can also, if you do things wrong, get a penalty. There's some fun stuff on that. You may have seen this, or you may have heard about this. This is an example of a violation of the social data guideline. And the reason for this particular one is kind of like twofold or threefold. It's not a true representation of the main content. It's misleading. And it's hidden, most likely. The last part is though a little bit of an assumption. Here what we see is, we see the rating for the same domain, three times, the exact same rating with the exact same quotes. The problem is that those ratings need to be for that page. Otherwise it's misleading. It's also not a true presentation of the main content. Yeah? Because that's off the website probably. This is probably in the sidebar. And the chances that it's hidden is because you can't add on every single page additional reviews. So likelihood, the mechanism to keep reviews is hidden, or the details of the reviews are hidden. So you're already violating three of the points. Now, the other one, one of the other ones was, for example, to stay up to date. Job application, jobs posting scheme is actually quite interesting because they took the next step here. And it's very interesting to read this because I don't know if you're familiar with it, but job posting is a schema that Google has recently adopted for testing purposes, and I'll talk about that in the coming few slides as well. But one of the things they've done here is go very, very strict. So for example, you have to have a sitemap. Yeah? You have to remove the page entirely if it's gone. If you don't, you may get a manual action for not removing the content on time. That is a lot stricter than what anything that else that we have. And this is in testing case. So this is the way that might be going. So keep that in mind when you think about structured data. And this is some of the messages you might see. Good news is any of those penalties can be resolved. Just keep that in mind as well. And as I mentioned, job posting is also interesting from another perspective. As with the new Google Search Console interface, we can see how Google is changing its perspective on presenting us with structured data. So we can now see, for example, more detailed information of when they solve specific issues. We get emails with that now. And on top of that, we can see it like in better interfaces. So we get more data from Google on this one, which is actually something I'm looking forward to, but keep an eye on the job posting one, because that's probably going to be kind of like a template for all the other ones in the near future. Yeah? When we go beyond web pages, structured data doesn't stop at web pages. Now obviously, we have custom fields. Nick talked about this morning, so I'm not going to talk about that today. Google Actions, same story. But those are places where you can also add and play around with structured data a lot. And for that reason as well, schema.org actually implemented something called Speakable and extended a lot of schemas with Speakable, which is a very interesting one if you're into voice search, as well as how-to. Don't forget the how-to. This is also relatively new and a very interesting development from a structured data point of view. One of the other places where you may not be used to looking for structured data is actually email. Yeah? Just to give you an example, this is just a check-in button, go-to stuff. You know, these are structured data. This is how you see that within an email. Yeah? So we can go with structured data, also think about outside the web pages. This is, for example, an article carousel inside an email that is shown by an array of article schemas. Yeah? So once you start thinking about structured data on your website, and you start thinking also about implementing that, start thinking about how you can also incorporate this in other places, because you're already doing it anyway. Yeah, why not reuse that for your emails, etc., or for your skills? Here, invoice. This is an invoice. Yeah, the schema for an invoice. So, and you can test it, by the way, how it looks in email. That's also a pretty cool one. So it's another tool that most people are not necessarily familiar on. Interesting part, if you look at the URL, just want to know, this is under the webmasters part, webmaster tools, most people don't know. But yeah, so having said that, just a couple of quick takeaways. Really why you should be implementing structured data is to help Google understand your content and understand your website. On top of that, use JSON-LD and audit your website regularly. Yeah, because you will find errors if you don't check it. And if you don't have it today, your implementation, you need to check that you don't send any conflicting signals. Because none of those tools that currently that I mentioned that are currently out there as promoted as the primary tools for checking schema actually check the content of the schema and how this relates to your website. Yeah, so you do need to audit. And if you're serious about SEO, I've said it on other occasions as well, you need to at least audit once a year as a bare minimum. And I'm sure that Nicola and Bas agree with me on that one. And I don't care if you do it yourself or if you let someone else do it, audit please. Yeah, you do need to know what's going on. Having said that, my name is Philip Wieser. Thank you very much. And if you're interested in the slide deck, if the button works, yeah. Send me an email through this website and I'll happily send you the slide deck with all the links in it. Just keep in mind that your inbox needs to be able to handle 20 megabytes. Because it's amazing how many rejections I get of sending slides on bounces because the mail server doesn't accept attachments above 5 megabytes or 10 megabytes. So please check that first. But yeah, if you have any questions, feel free to ask.